Back again, eh? Back for more chills and shivers? Well, come in. Come into the Crypt of Terror, and I'll dole you out your share. Yep, it's me, the Crypt Keeper, your host in horror. Just sit yourself down on that foul-smelling earthenware urn over there, and I'll entertain you. What's in the urn? Oh, that's what's left of Whitey Whittaker. Who's he? Well, you just settle down and I'll let you hear Whitey's story in his very own words. Ready? Whitey calls this cadaverous creation GAS-tly Prospects.
Jeff Whittaker's my handle, though some of the boys from the wagon train I joined up with to come west to California had nicknamed me Whitey. That's because I was no chicken, and my hair turned gray-white long years before. But I've been a prospecting fool all my life, and when they found the yellow stuff over at Sutter's Sawmill in 1848, I packed my dudge and headed west with the rest of the 49ers.
Wow, Whitey, we'll be in California by this time next week. What's your plans?
Me? I'm heading right for them gold fields. Gonna stake me out a claim and pan me a fortune. Yep, them were my plans. I had lots of high hopes in them days. Soon as we hit Sacramento, I lit out up the valley.
Keep going, stranger. This land's all staked out. Try about 10 miles further upriver.
Didn't take me long to find out that most of the gold had been played out by the time that I got there. Yeller-hungry critters had taken clipper ships around the Cape of Good Hope and beaten us overlanders to the fields. This stream's been panned out already. Finally, I decided to try up in the hills. I'd heard talk about rich veins being found. I bought me a shotgun so as I could hunt my own victuals, a pickaxe, and a shovel to dig with, and some canned beans. Spent every last dime I owned.
Better take some more shells, stranger. Gotta watch out for claim jumpers up in the hills.
Oh, that so? Let me tell you, that's beautiful country, them California hills. Towering pines whispering overhead, rushing streams cascading over rocks. Quiet lakes lying like looking glasses. I pitched me a tent next to one of them quiet lakes and made me a camp. This shore is pretty, but it ain't getting me rich. Tomorrow, I start digging. I tried a few spots without much success. Then I found me a stream feeding in the lake. She was a fast-running stream, coming down from them hills and a-bubbling out into the quiet lake, stirring it all up around the spot. What's that? Something shining in the water. It was gold, all right, and lordy, what a rich deposit. That there stream must have been rolling them nuggets down from the hill since time begun, and they were all laying right there for me. It'll take me a year to clean out this strike. I'm rich, rich. So I started panning. I figured on cleaning out the mouth of the stream where she emptied in the lake, then working my way upstream till I'd played the strike out. Look at this nugget. Must be a 4-ouncer at least. Then, about a month after I'd started working my claim, it happened. This big, burly-looking critter shows up. I'd panned me about $4,000 worth of gold by that time and was feeling pretty good. That was where I made my big mistake. I guess he'd been spying on me, and I let him get too close. Howdy, stranger. Where are you headed?
No place, bub. It's you. What's going?
He whips out his Colt 45 and fans it twice before I know what happens.
I'm taking over your claim right now.
Flat, flat. What? The two red-hot lead slugs catch me in the gut and I keel over. The pain is something awful and I'm boiling mad. When he comes over to see if I'm done for, I kick out at him. His Colt goes flying.
Huh?
Nobody steals what's mine, you ornery coyote. The gun lands off in the brush and the burly guy dives after it. I seize my chance and getting to my feet, hightails it for camp. Lordy, them slugs are burning in my middle.
Blast, where's that cursed iron?
I keep going, even though the pain is killing me. Back me, I hear him shout when he spies his 45.
Won't do you no good to run, stranger.
If I can get to my shotgun. A slug whistles past my ear and I tumble into camp. I grab my shotgun and the box of shells, duck behind a rock, and let go with both barrels. Here, you murdering snake! Now we're even, Steven!
Bam, bam!
The burly critter must have caught the sunlight glint on the shotgun barrel because he's behind a tree when the buckshot peppers round him.
Okay, stranger, I can wait. Let's see how long you can hold out with two slugs in your gut.
Shall we sit there, him behind the big old pine and me crouching behind that rock, bleeding like a leaky water bag?
One of us has got to fall asleep, and I ain't tired.
Oh, Lordy, if he don't get me, I'll bleed to death. I stuffed the shotgun shells from the box into my pockets and sit back to wait. I know I'm going to die, but I ain't gonna let him live either. You'll never take this claim, you snake. I'll get you first, I swear it.
I'm waiting, old-timer.
I guess I must have passed out from the pain, because the next thing I know, my eyes pop open and he's standing over me with a knife.
That'll teach you not to fall asleep.
I'm grinning at him and he's staring back at me. The knife is dripping blood. I try to grab for my gun, but I can't move a muscle. Funny, but I don't feel any pain either. So I knows that I'm dead.
Stop grinning at me, you old coot.
But I just keep grinning. He spits at me and goes and gets my pickaxe and shovel.
I'm gonna bury you, you old geezer. Then I'm gonna finish working your claim. Only now it's my claim.
So he starts digging. The ground is hard and he curses a lot. I just keep grinning at him. He's getting madder and madder.
Ah, to heck with it. This is good enough.
He grabs me and drags me over to the shallow grave he's dug out of the rocky loam. He kicks me in.
There. Rest in peace, you old prairie dog.
So I roll into the grave and land face up, staring at him and grinning at him. And he's red as a beet. He's so mad. He yells at me and flings a shovel full of dirt into my face.
Stop staring at me. Stop grinning at me. Shut your eyes when you're dead. Close your mouth.
Pretty soon I'm all covered and laying nice and cozy in my grave. I hear his hobnail boots crunching around over me as he stamps the ground down hard so you won't look fresh dug.
You were wrong, eh, old-timer? I got you first after all.
I figure I lay there a week or so in the ground. The crawling things start working on me. I don't feel them, but I know they're there because I can hear them scratching around me. Then after a long time, I hear something up above clawing at the ground. It's a wild cat digging me up. It clears a shot off in my face and shoulders, grabs my collar between its fangs, and pulls me up to a sitting position. Then, before it can start ripping me to shreds, another wild cat shows up. Right away, they start spitting and howling at each other. I sit there, grinning at them. They shale into one another, but soon the one that dug me up goes off a screeching and a nursing his wounds. Then the latecomer with one comes over, sniffs at me, and blopes off his shelf. I guess I'm too far gone to make good eating anymore. So I sit there, staring at my tent, listen to the burly guy snoring. He sleeps right through the melee. In the morning, he comes out of the tent. For a minute, I think his eyes are gonna fly right out of his head.
Good Lord!
He comes over to me, looking a little green around the gills. His mouth is dribbling a little spittle like he's been sucking on a bar of soap.
It ain't natural. Lay down. You're dead.
But I just sit there grinning at him. I can tell he's getting sore because his eyes is reddening up. He hauls off and kicks me in the face and I flops backward into my shallow grave.
So you won't stay buried, eh? You blasted old geezer.
He scrambles off toward the tent and comes back with the pickaxe and shovel. He grabs hold of me and drags me down to the lake.
Well, we'll see if you'll stay in the water.
He ties the shovel and the pickaxe to my feet with some rope.
This'll weight you down so you stay deep.
Then he hauls me into the lake. He pulls me out as deep as he can go and lets me settle to the bottom. I grin at his hobnail boots as I hit. The water starts filling into my guts and gurgling into my lungs. Some nosy fish come around peering at me. One of them takes a nip at my hand. I sway back and forth lazily. Where the rushing stream empties into the lake, a crazy current swirls. I'm laying right smack in the middle of it. Pretty soon I'm turning and twisting, and the ropes is rubbing on the sharp edges of the shovel. It takes about a week for the ropes to saw through. Meanwhile, the fish have been pecking away, and by the time I'm cut free, I'm in pretty sad shape. I'm all waterlogged and bloated, and the gashes that are formed in my insides force me to the surface.
Yeah!
I guess those crazy currents must have dragged me round and round, because I pop up right at the mouth of the stream where Burly Boy is panning. He nearly falls in the water when he spots me.
You're dead! Why in tarnation don't you stay dead?
He starts yelling and screaming at me, but I just stare at him and grin real silly-like. Only I don't look too humorous anymore. Fact is, I smell pretty bad, too. At least that's what he complains of as he drags me ashore. He lugs me over to the clearing and lays me in the middle. Then he starts dragging over logs he's been collecting.
If you won't stay buried and you won't stay drowned, maybe you'll stay burned.
I guess he was getting ready to build himself a cabin with them logs and stay over the winter. Anyway, he decides to sacrifice them all for me. He tosses me on the pile.
Let's see you come back from this, you blasted.
I'm laying there on the pile of logs in the middle of the clearing. All around the brush is dry, because it's been a dry summer. Right away, the flames are leaping around me. The heat is terrific. Of course, I don't feel nothing, but I can hear my waterlogged body a-hissing and a-popping. I guess I blacken up a bit and the water in my rotted clothes dries out. Soon they start to burn. I can sense something strange going on inside me, like I'm expanding from the steam and gases. Then, boom! There's a terrific boom, and I blow up! The shotgun shells I packed into my pockets go off like a dynamite charge. I rip into 1,000 pieces, and the expanding gases and compressed steam inside me sends the flaming hunks flying through the air. Argh! Some of me lands on the burly guy, and he's so busy peeling me off of him and patting out his burning clothes that he don't notice I've also landed all around the edge of the clearing, in the dry brush, in the tinder-like pines, everywhere. What a fire I start! In a couple of minutes, the whole clearing is surrounded by a circle of flame, a white-hot wall moving in on the burly critter. He don't stand a chance of getting through it. Tain't long till he starts shrieking in pain. But after a while, it's quiet, except for the crackling of the fire as it sweeps on through the dry wooded hills. I guess I can rest easy now. I plumb finished my work.
You plumb have, Whitey, and it sure were it sure was a doozy of a tale, eh, kiddies? You know, when I first told this yarn to my idiot editors, they confessed that they never knew a corpse could write his own story. I straightened them out, though. Whitey couldn't write his own name. He dictated the whole thing to me. A real ghostwriter, eh? Well, now I'll turn you over to the Vault Keeper. I'll see you later on.
You know, I'm really proud of my Crypt Keeper voice. It is not easy to do. I want to say a huge thank you to all of my amazing Patreon supporters who made this video possible, particularly Michael Fattori, Xana Zira, Break System BSE, and Zachary Snowden Smith for their ongoing and extremely generous support. There's also a new episode of I Will Say This Though over on that channel. I'll put a link in the description, where I, a first-time Futurama viewer and newcomer to the series, am ranking episodes of the first season. Spoiler alert, I like them all quite a bit. As it is now October for real, we are no longer rushing the Halloween season and simply doing the Halloween season, so I've got plenty more spooky content lined up, including another comic book story. But in the meantime, thank you for watching this one, and thanks for being you.